My name is Professor Sudeep Singh Sidhu, Assistant Professor of Civil Engineering Department and co-coordinator of this program. So I welcome you all in the session 2, day 3 of this 6-day online STTP on climate change and water security. So expert for this session is Dr. Yoga Lakshmi KN from Central University of Punjab. So let me take the privilege to introduce Dr. Yoga Lakshmi ji with you all. Dr. Yoga Lakshmi KN is currently working as an associate professor in the Department of Environmental Science and Technology at Central University of Punjab, Bathinda. She holds a master and PhD degree in environmental science from Anna University, Chennai. She has about 11 years of teaching and research experience and has published around 35 papers in high impact factor journals. She has also published 12 book chapters and presented papers in several national and international conferences within and outside the country. To her credit, she has around 35 lakhs worth research projects from various funding agencies like Board of Research in Nuclear Science, VRNS, and UGC. She has developed a number of e-content modules for EPG Pathshala in solid and hazardous waste management. She has also developed modules for a MOOC course on solid and hazardous waste management and is one of the popular course in SWAIM. She has guided 5 PhD, 7 MPhil, and 19 MSc students. She has also organized 2 national interdisciplinary workshops in environmental science discipline as co-coordinator of the Teaching Learning Center established under the Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya National Mission on Teachers and Teaching. So now I would like to request Dr. Yoga Lakshmi ma'am to please start with her expert lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, Engineer Sukhdeep. Thank you so much for such a nice introduction. Before I start, I personally thank the organizers for giving me an opportunity to deliver a lecture and share my thoughts about the climate change and water security. Let me share the screen. I think I'm audible enough, right?
Yes, ma'am. Perfectly audible.
Yeah. Just let me share my screen. Is my screen visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you see the presentation?
Yes, ma'am. It's visible, ma'am.
Okay. It's moving, right?
Right.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, participants, and thank you, organizers, once again for giving me an opportunity. Today, I'll be talking about the wastewater biorefinery and energy extraction from wastewater. Now, you would be wondering like how it is related to the theme of this FTP program, climate change and water security. Yes, climate change, like any other, it is affecting different sectors. Like if you see, it is affecting agriculture, it is affecting water resources, it has an impact on the soil, it is having an impact on vegetation. Every day, this has become a key word, and we are hearing many things about climate change. Now, same way, climate change is also having a great influence on the wastewater treatment system. Now, wastewater treatment system, as such, if you see like what impacts they cause. Now, wastewater treatment system, they are affected by climate change, and in turn, wastewater treatment systems are also causing or aggravating climate change on the other side. I would say it is in the sort of a cycle or a vicious cycle, I would say. Both vice versa. They are impacting that. Climate change is impacting wastewater, and wastewater treatment plants are in turn generating emissions which are aggravating the climate change. Now, I'll start off by just introduce what is wastewater. My presentation, I will for the next 2 hours, I'll take you through what is wastewater. Then we'll discuss about what is a wastewater treatment plant, and then what are the impacts that climate change cause on this wastewater treatment plants, and what are the emissions that come from the wastewater treatment plants that result in the release of gases, which is again contributing to the climate change. And then the second part of my presentation, I would be talking about how this impact can be reduced, in the sense, like, whatever emissions that come from the wastewater treatment plant, how it can be minimized. So what are the technologies that are there? What is coming up? What are the advancements that are there to reduce these emissions, so that to a certain level we can contribute or minimize the extent of climate change? So this would be the presentation, and I would be taking you for the next 2 hours. I'll be discussing about this. So I'm not aware about the audience. If they are a mixed audience, I'll keep it as simple as possible. So to start off, what is wastewater? I'm sure you have heard about this term. It is not a new word. Wastewater is something that is generated from the household activities every day, which is generated from the kitchens or laundry or washrooms, bathing, and then excreta, all put together, they come out of the residential areas. So that means wastewater is only from the generated from the residential area? No, it comes from the industry also. Industry, due to various activities, they use water. During the processing units, they generate wastewater that also comes out as wastewater. So globally, if you see, the wastewater generation is around 450 kilometer cube per annum. India alone, if you see, they generate around 61,754 MLD of sewage alone and 501 MLD of industrial effluent every day. Now, what happens to this wastewater? Now, whether it is just discharged? Yes. Now we are focusing on treating, but in the beginning, or you can say in a couple of decades back, 2 to 3 decades back, if you see, the wastewater that was generated was just let out or discharged into the water bodies, which in addition resulted in many other impacts on the water system or water bodies. Like when the pollution, the sewage or the industrial wastewater is let out into the water bodies, what happens is it adds carbon and the nutrients to the water system. So as a result, what happens, it results in the formation, algal blooms and eutrophication. Nowadays you cannot see any water body without any green plant, luxurious plant growth or algal blooms. So that is one thing. Another thing is all the pollutants that enter into the water body, they start, they result in, these pollutants, they enter into the water body when this water is consumed by the human beings or any living organisms. They create a lot of health hazards. So apart from health hazard, it also affects the environment. So in general, if you see, out of the 61,754 MLD of sewage that is generated, only 63% is treated. Rest is just discharged into the water bodies, and that is why today we are facing a lot of problem, especially here in Punjab. We also see these water pollutants are both geogenic as well as anthropogenic, and this discharge of domestic sewage or industrial effluent adds to the water pollution level. So as I mentioned, 63% is treated. Now, how it is treated? So you need a proper wastewater treatment plant, and how it is going to get treated. Now, I'll be focusing only on the domestic wastewater. Industrial effluent treatment plant are something different. Let's not touch about that. So yes, as I told you, since they cause detrimental effects on the environment and health of the human beings as well as every living organisms that exist in this earth, so you need to treat the wastewater before it is discharged into the water bodies to avoid all these menace that create on the environment. Now, what is a wastewater treatment plant? And here I have schematically portrayed a conventional treatment plant, which is generally used by, used in India in many places. If wherever you find a wastewater treatment plant, this is the conventional system which is existing. Now, the wastewater that is generated from different sources, like the residential area or from the commercial area, they are all brought to through a sewer network into a common point. From there, it is pumped. Using a pumping station, it is pumped to the first chamber. So before we look into the different units, process units, which are there in the wastewater treatment plants, the wastewater treatment as such is divided into three phases. The first phase is the primary treatment, second is the secondary treatment, and followed by the tertiary treatment. Now in primary treatment, there is no decomposition or degradation as such. It's only a physical separation. And the second phase does the major decomposition or mineralization of the organic matter which is present there. So, and the third phase is, the tertiary treatment is just a polishing, final chlorination, disinfection, and things will be done there. So, as I told you, through a main pumping station, the first, the wastewater enters into these green chamber. Now, in this green chamber, it is provided just to remove all the bigger floating materials. Like it can be a plastic wrapper, it can be a bottle, or it can be any twigs or logs or anything like that. The floatable materials will be removed or screened off in the screen chamber. Now, once these floatable materials are removed, it is taken, the water moves into the next chamber, that is a grit chamber. Now in this grit chamber, small materials like silt or small stone materials with materials with specific gravity of around less than 2.68, they are removed in this chamber. Now here the water is retained just for less than a minute, and once this grit material is removed, the water moves into the next chamber, that is the primary clarifier. Now in the primary clarifier, the water is allowed to settle. It is retained for a period of 2 hours where it is allowed to settle. Now we all know wastewater has solids in them. These solids are allowed to settle in this primary clarifier, and if there is any oily material which is there, that will be removed as scum in this chamber. So till here it is a primary treatment, and only physical process takes place, only the separation of floatable materials, grit, and other solid materials are done here. After this, the water moves into the second phase of the wastewater treatment, that is the secondary treatment, or it is also called as biological treatment. Here the main focus is the microorganisms does the degradation process. Here the microorganisms are they are subjected to the wastewater. The microorganisms use wastewater as a substrate, and they start consuming it. Now when they consume, they degrade and they mineralize also. They convert into products like carbon dioxide and water, right? Now once this for a specific period of time, you have to retain the water, which ranges from 8 to 12 hours, and after this treatment, the water moves into the next chamber, that is a secondary clarifier. Now in the secondary clarifier, again it is same as that of a primary clarifier, where the water is again retained for a period of 2 hours, and then the water settles down. Now here also, settling is facilitated so that the solids settle down and the supernatant moves into the next chamber. Now there's a difference between the primary clarifier and secondary clarifier. Is in primary clarifier, it is the solids, unprocessed solids, you can say. But in a secondary clarifier, it is a processed solid. Processed in the sense, these are the solid materials that are produced by the microorganisms which are there in the bioreactor. Now after this, the supernatant that is after settling, the supernatant just then moves into the third phase of the treatment process, that is the tertiary treatment. Now in the tertiary treatment, if you see, it is as I told you, it is only the polishing step. Here the fine materials like fine materials, here some organic constituents or any other color or volatile organic carbons, they are removed in this phase. So generally this tertiary treatment consists of either filters rapid sand filters, slow sand filters, or activated carbon filters to remove these materials. And the next followed by a disinfection tank. Now, the disinfection can be of any type. It can, you can use bleaching powder or chlorine gas can be used. Chlorine powder is used, or you can also use ozonation for disinfection. Now, here the purpose is to remove the coliforms and other microorganisms before they are discharged into the water bodies. Now, the solids that are produced at different phases of treatment, that is, from the primary clarifier, you have primary sludge that is being produced, and from the secondary clarifier, you have the waste activated sludge, or the processed biomass, you can say, or the processed solids. So these two are brought to a common point. They are pre-treated, like they are thickened, and then they are let into the anaerobic digesters. Now, anaerobic digesters, they there are specific group of bacteria. We'll be discussing those things in the later slides. So I'll just outline what is it is all about. Now, the anaerobic digester here, it is subjected to microorganisms. The microorganisms degrade the sludge and convert it into the value-added products like methane and carbon dioxide, which is collected and then used as biogas. Many of the treatment plants which are there, they have started using this biogas started collecting the biogas, converting it into electricity, and using it to run the same treatment plant. At least not completely, they are offsetting the charges, the electricity that is bought from the government. So otherwise, if it is not being converted into electricity and used, it is just discharged into the environment. And that is, again, one major reason for the climate change. Yeah. Now, here, we'll discuss about, as I told you, there are two aspects of climate change and its impact on the wastewater treatment. One is the wastewater treatment is impacted by climate change. And the other one is the wastewater treatment plants, they emit certain emissions, and these emissions cause climate change. So we'll be discussing we'll be discussing about that in these slides. Okay, now as I told you, climate change is becoming a main challenge for many sectors like agriculture, water resource, then you have vegetation, things like that. So same way, it is also having a major influence on the urban wastewater system. Now, they pose a lot of challenges. But before we I discuss about these challenges, I would like to brief you about what is climate change, what is greenhouse gas, and how it affects and all. I'm sure this is based, this workshop, FTP is based on climate change, and you must have heard about climate change for the past 2 days. You must have been hearing about it, but I'll keep it as brief as possible. Yeah. So, climate change, we all know, it's one of the burning word, I could say. Whatever happens, people start connecting it, and then they say it is climate change. It is because of climate change. When there is change in rainfall pattern, without even any understanding, people say, okay, there's a climate change, that is why there's change in rainfall pattern. Heat zyada ho gaya, there is a lot of heat, that is, the temperature is increasing, it's because of climate change. The wind patterns have changed, that's because of climate change. So there are, whatever happens in recent times, people connected to climate change. To a certain extent, yeah, it is true. Now, climate change is one thing which is caused by greenhouse gases, and it is predicted that by 2050, the temperature will rise by 2 to 5 degrees Celsius. Now, how does it affect? What does it actually do? Especially with related to water resources, it changes the temperature, and it plays an important role in the hydrological cycle. Now, they say, like, when there is warm word itself means that the atmosphere is having more capacity to hold water. Now, what happens during the this process of global warming, like there's heat, the greenhouse gases, they form a trap around the earth, and it does not allow the radiations to pass outside. So as a result, that there is changes in temperature. Now, this change in temperature will lead to evaporation of water from the Earth's surface. Now, this evaporation will result in the loss of water from the Earth's surface, and this water will finally end up in the atmosphere. So they say like every 1 degree increase in global temperature will result in almost 7% of moisture holding capacity or water holding capacity of atmosphere by 7 times. And also they say that more the moisture, of course, it is going to have an impact on the rainfall pattern. Now, rainfall pattern as such, if you see how it affects the hydrological cycle, if you see, on one side, you find the drought or arid and semi-arid areas are facing drought because of the water scarcity. On the other side, we are experiencing a lot of flood because of glaciers melting, sea level rise is there. So these things, again, there are different aspects how it is going to influence the wastewater treatment plant. So if you take rainfall, changes in the rainfall pattern, if you talk about, let's talk about increased rainfall. Now, when there is increase in rainfall, ultimately what will happen, more water will be there, and when it rains, all water will be flushed off through the urban or the stormwater channels, and ultimately end up in the wastewater treatment plant. When it ultimately ends up in the wastewater treatment plant, you generally design the wastewater treatment plant for a specific capacity or for the population that is existing there. But when there is excess of water that comes in, there will be overflow. When there is overflow, obviously the microorganisms levels and all will be directly taken up or discharged into the water body without any proper treatment. So there the system fails. That is one thing. On the other side, if you see in the arid and semi-arid regions where more increased intensity of drought is there, due to water scarcity, if there is no water, then the concentration of pollutants, the levels in the domestic wastewater will be very high. Flow, water is less, but the concentration is high. Again, the treatment plant which you have constructed for a specific flow and for a specific concentration, what will happen is less flow is coming, but more concentration, still it will not be able to take, and that again will create an impact on the wastewater treatment plant. Same is the case, like wherever there is a sea level rise, you will have saltwater intrusions will be experienced, and this saltwater intrusions will again have an impact on the groundwater as well as on the wastewater treatment systems, because the water that we start using will be saline in nature. When there is salinity increases, obviously the microorganisms will not do its work, because we depend on biological we do biological wastewater treatment, and which depends majorly on microorganisms, and the microorganisms will be lost. It will not be working properly. So again, that it's going to impact on the, it has that impact on the wastewater treatment plant. Likewise, if you talk about the glaciers melt, that again, it's going to lead to flooding. So every aspect of the climate change, that in, the every impact of climate change, it's going to affect the urban wastewater system in one way or the other. Yeah, so these things I've already told, like how the precipitation patterns are going to change the atmospheric vapor, evaporation rates, snow ice melting, changing patterns and all, and how this is going to, evaporation is going to increase, and then more water holding capacity in the atmosphere, and more rainfall which will come and then impact the climate change. So now, if you go back to this slide, it is more easy for you to understand. So what are the challenges? One, the regulatory burden, because there is a standard that is set by the Central Pollution Control Board, so which says that only this much COD or BOD should be there, this much solids should be there before the wastewater, before the treated water is discharged into the water body. Now, when such conditions, when there is excess flooding or when there is low flow or an increased concentration of pollutant, obviously this will not be possible. So there would be a great challenge in terms of regulatory burden. Same is the case of reducing emissions. When the concentration is high and the water is less, and moreover, you have a heated environment, the temperature is increasing. So the bacterial activity will be more. When bacterial activity will be more, more emissions of carbon dioxide, methane, and N2O gases would be there from the wastewater treatment plant. So that again will create a challenge on the wastewater treatment process. And the third one, how to adapt to this changing climate change, which we'll discuss in the third or the second part of the lecture. But this challenges, again, will not be constant or it will not be stable for across the globe. It will vary. It will vary depending upon the population level demography. It will vary depending upon the geography of the location wherever the plant is set up. It will also depend upon the administrative capacity and also the economics. How much funding is available and based on what technology you can use to minimize the impact, everything will vary from region to region across the globe. Yes. Now, little bit about the greenhouse gases, because that is the major reason for causing this climate change. Now, again, this you must have you might be knowing about this, and you must have been hearing about these greenhouse gases for the past 2 days. Now we have different gases like carbon dioxide, methane, fluorinated gases, and N2O as a major greenhouse gases. And here, carbon dioxide, these are the sources. Now in the couple of slides, I'll be talking about what are the sources from which these greenhouse gases are emitted, and how long does it stay in the atmosphere, and what is the global warming potential. Now, carbon dioxide, it's a very common gas which is released from the burning of fossil fuels, and also due to the during the production and transport of coal, natural gas, and oil. Same way, methane, it is very popular. It is generated from livestock farming, agricultural practices, waste dumping, and wastewater treatment process. Now, they have almost 21 times more potential to heat the Earth surface than carbon dioxide. And they stay in the atmosphere almost 12 years. So the next gas, nitrous oxide, again, they are released from agricultural, industrial activities, combustion of fossil fuels and solid waste. And they are also a very popular emitter from the wastewater treatment units. And they are released during the process of nitrification and denitrification, which occurs in during the process of wastewater treatment. Now, they have 310 times, they are more potent than carbon dioxide, and they remain in the atmosphere for almost 120 years. And the fluorinated gases, again, they are more complex. They hydrofluorocarbons, perfluorocarbons, and then sulfur hexafluoride. These are some of the fluorinated gases. And they are generally used as a substitute for ozone depleting substances, because ozone depletion was also a main thing which were creating an alarming attention almost a decade back. So the government and the government of all the country across the globe, they were talking about how to decrease this ozone depleting substances, and then they thought about replacing the fluorinated gases for CFCs and HCFCs. Now they are again causing a lot of impact on the greenhouse gases. Now the greenhouse gases, as such, if you see this HFCs, the hydrofluorocarbons, they have more. They have 11,700 times more potent than carbon dioxide, and they remain in the atmosphere for almost 15 years. Perfluorocarbons, they remain in the atmosphere for almost several thousand years, and they have 6,500 to 9,200 more capacity, more potent than carbon dioxide. And lastly, the sulfur hexafluoride, they are more dangerous. They live for a long period of time, and they have a very few sinks, and they have almost 24,000 times more potency than the carbon dioxide. Yes. So coming back, after a basic understanding about climate change, coming back to what impact that it creates on the wastewater treatment plant, I've outlined what it actually causes, but we'll look into the details one by one. Overall, if you see the climate change, it affects the sewage collection and the conveyance system. It affects the pumping system, Now, how sewage collection conveyance system is affected is like when the external environment, the temperature is very high. What happens is in the sewage collection system, when the sewage is moving across the sewer network, due to temperature, the bacterial activity starts in the sewer network. When the bacterial activity starts and there is anaerobic condition which exists there, again, there will be release of methane, carbon dioxide and H2S gas. Now this H2S gas, one, they will create a foul smell, and also they corrode the pipelines or the sewer networks. So that way it affects the sewage collection and conveyance system. You get a very foul odor, so that again disturbs the locality. So that's one thing. Pumping stations are affected because again, corrosion, it corrodes the pipelines and things. And the wastewater treatment plant is affected. The treated effluent pipelines, again, it is affected. Outfalls to the receiving water body. I told you, like, if there is overflow of water during flooding conditions, all the microorganisms, because wastewater, they have a lot of pathogens in them because it carries the excreta and all the water that is generated from the washing and cleaning activities. So it has a lot of pathogens and microorganisms which are not safe to be let out or discharged into the external water body. So in that case, what happens when it is directly discharged, then the epidemic of the spread of diseases like cholera, the waterborne diseases or the spread of diseases are more prone. So that is more important, which you have to take care of. And last, the sludge management units, the sludge treatment. If you remember in the wastewater treatment plant, I was talking about the anaerobic digesters. So from anaerobic digesters, methane and carbon dioxide will be there. More increased temperature, and that will result in more better activity, more faster generation of methane and carbon dioxide. So these are some of the ways by which the climate change is having an effect on the wastewater treatment plant. Now, this is what I was talking about. So an increase in temperature will generally lead to the hydrogen sulfide production, which causes odor problem, increases the corrosion, and also they increase the energy requirement of the operating aerators. Also faster, more temperature, faster bacterial activity, faster conversion process, and it removes the increases the removal efficiency. Also, it can be taken on a positive note. Then this also I told, the sea level rise. When there is a sea level rise, there will be salt water intrusion that will have a lot of load on the hydraulic capacity of the sewers in the downstream. And also they'll increase the salt water intrusions, which will result in the saline conditions in the wastewater treatment plant, and that will affect or impact the microorganisms which are there in the biological treatment, and that in turn will decrease the treatment efficiency. Now this, on the other side, what happens when there is intense rainfall activity due to climate change? One, the flood basically will damage the infrastructure. Second, I told you there will be overflows because the treatment plant, which is constructed for a specific volume and for the specific concentration, it will not be able to take so much of water. Though the concentrations are less, the concentration gets diluted, but the water level is high depending upon the intensity of rainfall. So when the sewage overflows are there, all the pollutant, the carbon, the nutrients, the microorganisms, everything overflows and then it reaches the water body. And what happens is also when there is increased temperature, it alters the biology and the chemistry of the treatment process of the microorganisms which are existing there. And also when the wastewater treatment plant is constructed with the purpose of having when it is constructed for a purpose of reusing it, then it creates a problem. For example, if the water, the wastewater treatment plant, let's imagine it is built in a place, a decentralized place. Let's imagine there is in our university, we have a wastewater treatment plant. There is a heavy rainfall and we are planning to use it, the wastewater is generally being reused. When there is heavy rainfall, what happens is flooding will be there, and when the water reuse quality will not be achieved. The standard which is set for water to be reused will not be achieved. And as a result, what will happen is it will also create a problem. Diseases, a spread of diseases, and the pollutant levels will be high. So such problems will be there. And again, this the pathogens and coliforms which are there in the sewage that will also be let out into the water bodies, which can cause more diseases when there is things occur when there is intense precipitation, when there is change in the rainfall pattern and rainfall. Then likewise, I told you that during droughts also, like when there is a drought conditions, what will happen? Because in arid and semi-arid regions, again, in the increase in temperature will lead to water scarcity because of drought. And due to water scarcity, water will be less, but the level of pollutants that is coming out, the organic matter or nutrients or solids, that will be the same, but the water availability will be less. So in that case, what will happen is water will be less, concentration is more. Again, that is going to have an influence because the efficiency of treatment will be minimized. So an increased occurrence of low flows will lead to decreased containment dilution capacity and higher pollutant concentration, which results in, which affects the treatment system, treated effluent. I'm sure till here I'm fine. Can I proceed?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Now we'll discuss about how each unit in a conventional treatment process is getting affected. Now, showed you the schematic of a wastewater treatment plant, the biological treatment, I told you it's conventional process where activated sludge process is being used. Now, this activated sludge process, overall, if you see how it is getting affected due to changes in the climate change, we'll discuss that. And what are the different one we'll discuss this, and then we'll talk about the emission aspect, how wastewater treatment plant are emitting gases and how this gas is impacting the aggravating the climate change. Now, the different unit-wise, if you remember sedimentation. Sedimentation means the clarifiers, the primary and the secondary clarifiers. There also, there's a problem, like when there's increase in temperature, the warm wastewater will increase the bacterial activity and it will reduce the density of sludge. When the density of sludge is reduced, the sedimentation tank, which depends mainly on the settling, so if the sediment, the density of settled sludge gets reduced, what happens is, the sludge will not settle and there will not be any solid liquid separation between them. So as a result, the settling will not occur properly. And when the water moves after the specific retention time into the next chamber, the solid materials will be discharged into the next system. It will keep moving and then finally it will get it will enter into the water bodies, and again it will accelerate other problems and health hazards. So that is one thing. Second thing, the aeration systems are generally affected because at high temperatures you need the operating systems are affected, and also process wise if you see, nitrification process is favored more, and as a result during nitrification nitrate formation would be there. Now we all know nitrate is another important groundwater pollutant, and it results in the formation of methemoglobin anemia in infants, so which is again a serious problem, and that is another aspect. Now in the unit where the processing of sludge takes place, like the anaerobic digesters, there also what happens is the waste activated sludge it needs to be thickened for efficient generation of gases. That is another way how the climate change impacts the waste processing, the sludge processing unit. Same way, chlorination is also affected in chlorination tank, because when there is flooding, more overflow of pathogens are there, or during drought condition when more intensity of pathogens are there, then you tend to add more chlorine doses are required than normal conditions. So that again influences the chlorination tank. Now, till here we have discussed like how the climate change is impacting the wastewater treatment. Now, on the reverse side of the coin, now how wastewater is generating certain emissions and how these emissions are aggravating the climate change, we'll discuss about that. Now, we all know, this process which is there, it emits these greenhouse gases like carbon dioxide, methane, and N2O. They are emitted at different parts or different units of the wastewater treatment plant. So generally, if you talk about overall perspective, overall, holistically, if you see, carbon dioxide is emitted in every unit wherever aerobic oxidation process takes place. Likewise, same is the case of methane. It is emitted from every unit where anaerobic degradation takes place. And the N2, which is the nitrous oxide, you can see if you remember the nitrogen cycle, where the ammonia is oxidized to NO2 and NO3. And during denitrification, NO3 is converted back to NO2 and NO2 to NO, NO to N2O, and then finally N2 gas is produced, which is the safest gas, which is released into the atmosphere. But N2O, again, we have seen it remains in the atmosphere for around 310 years, and it has more global warming potential. So, it has 310 times more global warming potential as carbon dioxide, and it remains there in the atmosphere for almost 126 years. So, again, they are dangerous, and this N2O is produced from all the units which where nitrification and denitrification generally takes place. So carbon dioxide and N2 emissions, where the biotreatment or endogenous respiration or BOD oxidation takes place, every unit will emit these two pollutants. Same is the case wherever nitrification or nitrogen removal occurs, you will find the emission of N2O. And wherever the energy use of the plant, wherever you use pumps or any pumping systems or aeration or mixing units, again, there will be release of carbon dioxide because all these units require energy. And same is the case of sludge digestion, where methane and carbon dioxide is emitted. Same way, when the sludge collection disposal, where we use trucks for carrying the sludge from the treatment plant to the disposal site, again, there is a lot of emissions because fuel consumption would be there. From the process also, carbon dioxide emissions and mineralizations, all these things are there. And same is the case like when you don't use biogas or convert it into electricity and then use it as a substitute or offsetting the electricity charges, then again, that is released into the atmosphere and it will create a problem. So that is one aspect. But if you are using biogas, converting it to electricity, then you are offsetting the generation of methane and carbon dioxide. And as I told you, only very few treatment plants use collect biogas and convert it into electricity. So that is again a problem, how these emissions will come and then aggravate the climate change. Then the greenhouse gases are also emitted from the chemicals which are used during the wastewater treatment. Now, this schematic gives an overview like how different gases are produced from different treatment processes. If you see, as I told you, like anoxic treatment, anoxic means it is having less oxygen, and oxygen, especially in the combined form, like nitrates, phosphates, sulfates. So in anoxic treatment, more of carbon dioxide and N2O is produced. And when you talk about, when we look into the aerobic system, they release both carbon dioxide and N2O. Same is the case like during pumping. Wherever this energy is used for pumping and all, there again CO2 is used. Then you can see from the settling unit, CO2 and N2O being released. From the sludge treatment unit, you have methane, carbon dioxide, and during release or the sludge disposal, again, due to fuel, consumption by the combustion by trucks, you have emission of these gases and methane, carbon dioxide, while carrying also whatever is locked in the sludge, that is again released. And that's how the overall whatever I've discussed so, till now regarding the emissions has been picturized in this schematic. Now, overall, if you see, they say, the little bit of statistics across the globe, if you see the wastewater treatment plants generally contribute around, they are the fifth largest source of this anthropogenic methane and the sixth largest contributor for N2O. In terms of methane, they are the fifth largest source, and in terms of N2O, they are the sixth largest contributor. Now, if you take these major countries like India, China, and USA, Indonesia, they alone contribute to around 49% of world's methane emission. Same is the case for N2O, it is around 50%. These four countries are contributing. So this it's data from EPA. EPA has reported as per 2019, they have reported how much methane and how much N2O is emitted from domestic and industrial wastewater treatment plants. And these are expressed in terms of million metric tons of carbon dioxide equivalent. Now, if you can see methane, which is generated from the domestic and the industries from 1990 to 2017, the trend of methane, it's in with respect to the domestic wastewater, it is decreasing. This is because they say like most of the places, like in the conventional treatment units, even today, if we see the wastewater that comes from the individual house, it goes into the septic tank where minimum settling or anaerobic degradation takes place, and then only the water goes into the sievers or manholes, and then it is brought to the treatment plant. But nowadays, this septic, the concept of septic tanks are not there, and the anaerobic processes are not there, especially in the at every household level. So that is why they say there is a decrease you can see in terms of methane. But in industries, more industries are being added, and these industries are basically where the breweries and food production industries. So they are getting added, and that is why there is an increase with as we go from 1990 to 2017. Now, but N2O, it is a different trend. It is continuously increasing. For that, according to EPA, they say the protein consumption and the urea usage is very high, and that is why the N2O N2O emissions are increasing. So overall, if you see with the increase in overall the greenhouse gas emissions, if you see from 1990 to 2017, it is increasing, and it has increased from 18.72, it has reached up to 19.2. yes. Now, till now, we have discussed about the what is wastewater, how a wastewater treatment plant looks like, and how the climate change is impacting the wastewater treatment system, and how the emissions from the wastewater treatment plants are aggravating the gases which contribute to climate change. Now, as I told you, the second part of my presentation, what we would be seeing is like how this is going to impact, the modification of technology, or how different techniques or advancements in this wastewater treatment plants are there so that to reduce or minimize the emissions that come from the wastewater treatment plant. So that is what we will be discussing in the second part of my presentation. Nowadays, if you see, wastewater is not considered as a wastewater. Now, people have started giving a different perspective to wastewater, and they have researchers and scientists, they have started thinking wastewater as a resource, because the wastewater, if you see, they contain a lot of organic richness in them. So now, with this organic richness, why don't they trap this organic richness and convert it into either a form of energy or any other value-added product? So wastewater is no longer thought of as a waste material, but it is being thought in a different angle as a resource, because as I told you, they are organically rich, and they say one meter cube of wastewater that is produced every day, it contains around 37,052 tons of COD. COD is nothing but the chemical oxygen demand, the organic richness. So that much organic constituents are locked in wastewater. So if we trap them and convert it into energy, one, the energy problem can be solved. Even at least if it is not used as a substitute for, day-to-day activities, at least even wastewater treatment plants, which we are operating, that is using a lot of energy. So the energy that is produced from the wastewater treatment plants can be used as an offset for running the wastewater treatment system, and it can be a self sustainable system. So that way, at least it can substitute the electricity charges which a wastewater treatment plant is consuming. So the angle or the focus has been shifted from treatment and discharge to the trapping of energy. So a paradigm shift is required to think wastewater as a resource. It is already there, but still it is not so very popular, and it is still, I would say, in the infancy. Not the complete potential is not still explored. Okay, so and this practice is only in few countries they do. Rest of the countries, especially the underdeveloped and developing countries, they are not focusing on this aspect, which is very, very important. When this aspect is considered, there are many problems which can be solved. One is energy problem, energy crisis is solved, water crisis is solved. Again, water treatment will be treatment efficiency will be increased, more water can be reused, and also the climate change problem can be solved. So that is how the wastewater is going to solve as a resource. Now, as I told you, resource we'll be talking about in the energy perspective. Now, is the wastewater alone having this organic richness? No. Even the sludge, there are two components in the wastewater treatment, like be it a wastewater or the processed or unprocessed solids, the sludge, which is called as, they both have a potential. They have so much of organic richness locked in them. And when these two, from them, you can trap the resource or the organic richness and convert it into energy. The energy can be in form of biogas or directly in form of electricity. So we'll see, discuss about what are the technologies or the units which are used for converting or trapping energy from wastewater. So we'll discuss both wastewater as well as sludge. Now, in general, first we'll begin off, we'll start off with sludge, and then we'll discuss about the wastewater. Now, sludge, if you see, it is produced from the primary clarifier and the secondary clarifier. In the primary clarifier, it is just a solid which is removed by physical separation. And here also it is physical separation, but the solids that is retained here, they are produced by the microorganisms. And generally the sludge as such, if you see, it has 98 to 99% water. Just it has only 1% solid. And this 1% solid has around 30 to 55% of organic matter in them, 3% of nitrogen, 0.7 to 1.5% of total phosphorus, 7% of total potassium, and other heavy metals and ions are there. And they also have some recalcitrant, and then xenobiotic compounds are also found in the sludge material. Now, if you look into the calorific value of sludge, it ranges from 12,000 to 15,000 kilojoules per kg. So that much energy potential is locked in sludge. If we explore it properly, then so much of energy can be produced successfully from the sludge. Now, what is the technology that is used for producing energy from sludge? This is again a conventional technology, the anaerobic digesters, which I told you it is existing there in the treatment plants. Many treatment plants, they are using anaerobic digesters. Now, anaerobic digesters is not so complex. Here in Punjab, I think everybody must have seen a biogas plant. Right, so biogas plant works under the principle of anaerobic digestion. So same thing here also in a wastewater treatment plant. Also, anaerobic digestion or anaerobic digesters are used. Now, what is anaerobic digestion? Anaerobic digestion is a process where the biodegradable organic matter are broken down by the action of microorganisms, and generally it is done in the absence of oxygen. Now, products that are produced, one, biogas, which is composed of carbon dioxide, methane, and other trace gases, and also a nutrient-rich digestate is produced. Okay, now this can be again further depending upon the characteristics, it can be used as a fertilizer. Again, it again has a lot of nutrients and organic richness, you can use it. So the process of anaerobic digestion, it's done, basically it follows, it's a four-step process, starting from hydrolysis, then acidogenesis, acetogenesis, and then followed by methanogenesis. Now, the four-step process, the first process or the first phase, you can say the hydrolysis, it is very simple. I mean, it is just the conversion of complex material into simple polymers. I mean, the complex biopolymers like protein, polysaccharides, lipids, and fats, they are converted into simpler substances by the means of hydrolysis. Now, once they are converted into the simpler monomers and oligomers like sugars, amino acids, and peptides or fatty acids, now they are further subjected to the second phase, like acidogenesis. Now here, the acidogenic, different group of bacteria play a role in different phases. In hydrolysis, for the conversion of complex biopolymers into simple biopolymers, hydrolytic bacteria are used. And for the conversion of the simple monomers into the acids, like propionate and butyrate, and then propionate, butyrate, acetates and all, they are done by a specific group of bacteria called as acidogenic bacteria, and they convert them into acetates by acetogenesis phase, where acetates and hydrogen and carbon dioxide is produced. Now, after that, the last phase, the acetogens convert this acetates into the methanogens, the last group of bacteria, the methanogens, they convert these acetates, hydrogen and carbon dioxide, into methane and carbon dioxide in the last phase. So there are four groups of population of bacteria which are there, and they convert these the complex biopolymers by anaerobic digestion into simple gases like carbon dioxide, methane, and hydrogen. So if you need to produce, if you don't want carbon dioxide and if you don't want methane, which is having a global warming potential, you can stop at this phase, like after acidogenesis, you can stop because hydrogen is produced. You know, hydrogen is a clean gas. Yield also. So this is the process of or the phase of anaerobic digestion. Now let's look into the composition of biogas that is generated by through anaerobic digestion of municipal sewage sludge. So if you look into the composition, the major gas is methane, which occupies around 55% to 75% of the total gas, and 25% to 45% is carbon dioxide, and rest is contributed by the trace gases. Now, trace gases, as such, if you see, it is water, hydrogen sulfide, ammonia, nitrogen, then oxygen and hydrogen. So these are the trace gases. Now, same way, this biogas has a, just like sludge, biogas also has a very high calorific value of around 18,630 to 26,080 kilojoules per meter cube. Now, the biogas, again, it can be cleaned, compressed and used as a natural gas. And it is generally called as a methane gas because a major proportion is methane. Again, they can be cleaned and then brought to natural gas standards. Now, they say around 1 ton of sewage sludge can generate around 47 meter cube of biogas. So this is how anaerobic digesters look like. It's similar to a biogas digester. And here, you can see, I'll not get into the process design or things like that. I'll just brief you like what it, the operating conditions. So here you can see the substrate is added through the substrate inflow. It comes inside, you have a mixer. Mixing is done to enhance the I mean, see, because here you're not supplying any oxygen. It's an anaerobic process. It works in the absence of oxygen. So when the waste, I mean, waste is waste or the wastewater or the waste sludge is added into the anaerobic digesters, it remains and it'll since there is no aeration, it'll settle down and it'll form layers in there. So when these layers are being formed, maybe this image will give you a better idea. So on the left hand side, if you see when it is just added and then let for the process to take place for the conversion of biogas, what happens is the thick sludge settles at the bottom, which is depicted by the red color zone, and the gray color it's like a semi solid form of the sludge and water mixed condition will be there, and on top you have the supernatant with little bit of solids floating in them. A normal anaerobic digester, this is how it looks like. But here the problem of this digester, yes, it will produce gas, but since there's no mixing, okay, so the bacteria, the contact between the substrate and, I mean, there will be mass transfer limitation. And as a result, there will be slow production of gas. But if you put some mixers and then give a mixing so that there will be uniform distribution of microorganisms, the mass transfer limitations are minimized. And as a result, more faster and better biogas productions can be obtained. So that is why this system, it's modified by adding a stirrer. So you can see a stirrer which mixes the system for facilitating better gas production and faster gas production. So the operating conditions as such, if you see, it ranges from 6.5 to 8, the pH. Temperature, I mean, generally they are done under mesophilic phase, ranging from 20 to 40 degrees Celsius. And if the thermophilic condition, I mean, higher temperature, if it is done, it ranges from 45 to 60 degrees Celsius. The retention period is 20 to 35 days, and feeding can be done continuously or intermittently also. So, again, I'm not getting into the technical details, like the three steps would be there. First, the solids are liquefied, then it is digested, and then gas is produced. So these are three different types of digester. The conventional or single stage digester is also called as low rate digesters because it does not have a stirrer. So as a result, the gas production is delayed and slowed also. Now, next, I mean, the high rate digesters, where you provide it with either the digesters or the gas that is produced can be recirculated to enhance or facilitate proper mixing. So that also can be done. So it is a high rate digesters where the gas production is faster and occurs within a small period of detention time. Now, the two stage digesters, what happens is sometimes if you look into the graph how the gas is being produced, initially the gas production will be slow, then it peaks out, and after some time it will stabilize. Now, instead of holding it in this primary digester, you can have a second digester where this digestate can be added. And there for completion, maybe once it stabilizes, maybe it will hardly produce 5 to 7% of gas. So instead of occupying the main digester, this can be taken into a substitute or the second digester where the further gas production will take place. So that is a two-stage digesters. So these types of digesters are generally, used for the anaerobic digestion or the biogas production in the wastewater treatment plants. So this is, again, it shows clearly how a two-stage digester, first digester, it is set up with a proper stirrer or the gas recirculation, which facilitates faster production of biogas, more product within a short period of time, more biogas is produced. And whatever, once it stabilizes, the rest 5 or 7% can be produced in the second digestate, where you don't have to produce any mixing or stirrers or any recirculation is expected. So again, this is how a two-stage digesters work. Now, a little bit of comparison about how low-rate and high-rate digesters they work. When they, the solids in low-rate digesters are very less. High-rate digesters, you can load more solids. but the detention time is less as compared to low rate digesters because you provide stirrers and then gas recirculation. So hydraulic retention time is also reduced, and the gas production, it's around 0.65 for low rate digesters and 0.5 for high rate digesters. However, like high rate digesters, the consumption of electricity is high because you are giving in more of the mixing and all takes more energy. Yes. Now, why the characteristics of sludge is projected here is, now here, of course, yeah, the conventional treatment plant, it is having anaerobic digesters. They are extracting biogas. They are digesting sludge. The biogas is generated. Some treatment plants, they convert it to electricity. They are using it. And some, they are let out. But even after providing anaerobic digestion or digesting the sludge, it is reported like 40% of organic richness is still locked in the sludge even after anaerobic digestion. So they say if a proper treatment, pre-treatment is, if it is given to the sludge, then that will facilitate better extraction of biogas. I hope you understand, because the sludge that is digested in the anaerobic digester, after it is being digested also, still almost 40 to 50% of the organic richness is still locked inside. Now, when it is locked inside, now the exact potential of the organic richness is not trapped by the anaerobic digesters. So if you see these column, like you have the primary sludge, secondary sludge, which is generated from the primary clarifier, secondary clarifier, and this is a characteristic of the digested sludge. Now you can see almost, the digested sludge also has so much of calorific value. So let's not discuss about the other characteristics. If you look into the energy content and the calorific value, the calorific value of the digested sludge, it still has around 3000 locked in it. Now, to facilitate extraction of biogas, there are certain pre-treatments required. Now, before getting into the pre-treatment aspect, let's talk about the limitations which are existing there. Now, what limits the incomplete, or why is that 40% which is locked is not able to, which is limiting the anaerobic digester to trap the 100%, which what are the limitations? Now, one thing is like, the anaerobic digestion has a rate limiting step, that is the hydrolysis step. Now hydrolysis, the first step, if you look into the anaerobic process, the first step, the hydrolysis step, is rate limiting because it shows a lower organic degradation. It requires longer retention time. The digester volume is big volume. Volume requirements are very high, and also capital cost requirement is very high. Now, moreover, as I told you, the sludge that is added into the anaerobic digesters, they are highly complex. They are highly complex, and it is difficult for the anaerobic bacteria, which is there in the digester, to break this sludge. Because if you look into the sludge, it is the enzyme, the extracellular polymeric substances, they form a network within which the microorganisms or the biomass or the dead cells, everything is locked. Now, it is difficult for the anaerobic bacteria to break this sludge, enter into, and then consume the substrate. So that is the limitation why the 40% of organic richness is still locked in the sludge even after 40 days of retention. So here, complex microbial flock structure of the waste activated sludge, it acts like a chemical and a physical barrier for the penetration of hydrolytic enzymes, and as a result, when the enzymes does not enter into these complex matrix, what happens is the intracellular locked organic matter cannot be consumed by the microorganisms, and as a result, it limits. So this can be sorry. this can be achieved only through certain pre-treatment. Now, pre-treatment are of different types. You can give a thermal pre-treatment, you can give a mechanical pre-treatment, you can go for chemical, biological, or any form of combined pre-treatment. Now, thermal pre-treatment is nothing but you subject or heat the sludge, and it ranges from 140 to 170 degrees Celsius. Treatment time can be 30 to 90 minutes. This type of treatment, they say, they increase the energy yield by 16 to 54%. I mean, the biogas yield is increased by 16 to a maximum of 54%. But the limitation of this pre-treatment is it results in the generation of a lot of refractory compounds. So that is one thing. The second type of pre-treatment, the mechanical pretreatment, again, if you talk about mechanical pretreatment, there are four different types of mechanical pretreatment, starting from ultrasonication, microwave, electrokinetic disintegration, high pressure homogenization. All these things are used. So ultrasonication, what happens is there you subject it to it is a sort of mechanical treatment where when the ultrasonication or ultrasonic waves is given to the sludge, small cavities or bubbles, they are produced. Now, when this bubble or cavities, cavitation or bubbles produced, they immediately break. When they break, they generate a localized heat in that particular region. So now this heat again results in the heat and pressure again results in the breakdown of sludge matrix. So the frequency that is used is around 20 to 40 kilohertz, and the methane generation increases by 35 to 95%. Now similarly, microwave, what happens is the heating, the heat range around 1250 watt is used, and this heat, what happens is it alters the dipole movement of the polar molecules. Now, as a result, it results in the breakdown of the hydrogen bond, and the sludge breaks. Now, this method of pretreatment is reported to increase the biogas generation by 31 to 50%. Now, electrokinetic disintegration, again, it is reported to increase the biogas generation by 33 to 40%. And here a pulsated electric field is created. Now, when this pulsated electric field, what it does is, again, it breaks the, it cleaves the bonds. And as a result, the intracellular contents are released, and it facilitates the consumption by the microorganisms. Now, lastly, high pressure homogenization. Again, here more pressure and turbulence is given, and as a result, the sludge breaks, and it is reported like a twofold increase in biogas yield is achieved by high pressure homogenization. Now, coming to chemical treatment, acid, alkali, ozonation, phenton, and Fe2 activated persulfate oxidation is used. Now, acid and alkali, simple. These acids and these alkalis are used, and pH as low as 2 can increase the biogas generation up to 14%. Same as the case of alkali, again, it increases 5 to 15% of biogas. But only thing is, the disadvantage, though it does a better production, you need neutralization. Once these acids or alkalis are subjected, before adding it into the digesters, neutralization is required. Then ozonation, it depends upon the dose. The dose ranges from 0.05 to 0.5 gram of ozone per gram of total solids that is loaded. And it is reported to increase the biogas yield by twofold. And also the high ozone dose, it leads to complete mineralization. And sometimes when there is residual ozone which is there, it also affects the microorganisms. When the pre-treated sludge is added into the digester, it will also affect the microorganisms, and then that is going to negatively impact the process. And moreover, ozone is a very energy intensive and a costly process. And coming to phenton, Fe2 plus and H2O2, that is a phenton reaction. It generates hydroxyl radicals, and due to the oxidation potential of these radicals, it breaks the sludge. And it is reported to increase the biogas yield by 30 to 40%. Now, lastly, about the ferrous to activated persulfate oxidation. Here again, persulfates are produced and they are generally activated by heat or UV. It produces the sulfate radicals, and these sulfate radicals, they have an oxidation potential of -2.6 volt. Again, the pH ranges from 3 to 8. That also favors better biogas, increased biogas production. The overall, I mean, this table summarizes the advantages and disadvantages of the different pretreatment methods, especially the thermal, acid, and alkali. So overall, thermal, I told you, recalcitrant compounds are produced or inhibitory compounds are produced, which affects, that is the disadvantage. Plus temperature, again, it leads to high energy demand. Advantage, it breaks the cell. Cell lysis is better and it increases surface area. Same as the acid. Again, here you have inhibitory compounds like furfurils and methoxyfurfurils are produced. It will affect on a thing. I mean, it inhibits. Corrosion problems are also faced and you need neutralization. But on the positive side, if you see, they solubilize the cellulose and hemicellulose. And so that is why it is considered better and it provides better polymerization efficiency. Now, talking about mechanical, again, it increases the accessible surface area. It does not create any odor or it favors better dewatering of a sludge. But on the other side, it is a costly technology because it demands a high startup cost and demand of electricity is more. Now, biological methods are very cheap, where microorganisms or some enzymes are used to disintegrate the sludge. But on the other side, they are very, slow. The microorganisms, first they have to establish themselves and they'll degrade slowly. So it is a time-consuming process, but however, they are eco-friendly. Now, so this is about the technology for extracting energy from sludge. Now, there are technologies for extraction of energy from wastewater also. So, three different technologies are there. One is the upflow anaerobic sludge blanket reactor, then the anaerobic baffle reactor, and the third one is the bioelectrochemical systems, microbial fuel cells and microbial electrolysis cells. Now, for extracting energy from wastewater, this is one of the conventional technology. Like for aerobic system, I told you activated sludge process is conventional, conventional system. Same way, if you talk about anaerobic system, UASP is more popular. Now this, again, you can see this is how the reactor looks like. Here the water or the influent wastewater is let at the bottom and it is let in at the bottom and slowly the water it percolates through a thick bed of sludge, and once it percolates through the thick bed of sludge, the wastewater comes in contact with the microorganisms. The microorganism starts consuming the wastewater and they degrade and mineralize, and they generate, produce gases like methane and carbon dioxide. And this gas slowly will percolate out through the sludge blanket and it will reach the top, towards the top part of the reactor. Now you can see the red and yellow balls. Okay, so the gas balls, bubbles are represented by yellow color, and the granules are represented by the orange color. And when this gas, when they move, sometimes they tend to carry this small sludge materials along the gas bubble. So that is why there are baffles produced. You can, provided you can find baffles on either side of the reactor. Now the gas material will hit, when it hits on the baffle, the sludge material will drop back into the sludge bed and only the gas is collected in the dome, and the gas will be collected. So this is how the system works. It is again the same system as that of an anaerobic digestion process takes place, but there it was thick sludge, here it is wastewater, and there the sludge itself had a microorganisms. Here you have a sludge blanket which is there, which is having microorganisms, and this microorganisms is going to work and degrade. So the again, the clarified effluent after treatment, the clarified effluent is extracted from the top of the tank. So yeah. So if you look into the advantages of this process, it has a very high BOD removal efficiency. Biogas generation is there. It can withstand shock loads. So if you ask me what is a shock load, sudden changes in the environmental conditions, like when there's a sudden change in flow, when there's a sudden change in concentration, especially when we are talking about technology suitable for climate change. Climate change is one thing, it is going to cause more of a flood, more of, less water, more pollutants. So in all those cases, this system is sturdy, robust, and it can withstand these shock loads. So operation cost is also very less because it does not require any aerators or things like that. So it also produces less sludge because anaerobic reactors are very slow. They produce a very small quantity of sludge, unlike your aerobic systems. Now, the disadvantage on the other side, if you see, it requires a very long startup because they are anaerobic systems, so it takes time to start. But once the system is maintained, it will work properly and it gives the better efficiency. And also the effluent quality, because shock loads, of course, the effluent quality will vary and sometimes it requires further treatment. So that becomes a disadvantage of this process. Now, the second system, this is one of a decentralized system, anaerobic baffled reactor. Again, it is a modification of upflow anaerobic sludge blanket reactor. But only thing is, this is a decentralized system and it is used in... I'm sure you understand what is decentralized and centralized. Centralized is a common treatment plant and decentralized is like, for example, a treatment plant is established, if it is established for a hospital or an industry, for a university, they are all decentralized because the water that is generated in that zone, it is treated. And if it is reused, it's okay. Otherwise, treated water is let into the common sewers. So that is a decentralized plant. So anaerobic baffled reactor is again a very good example of wastewater for the extraction of energy from wastewater, and it's a decentralized plant. These systems are more popularly installed, even like if in an apartment or in a township, even they can be very easily established below your car parking surface. So it will work underground completely without any chaos or disturbance. And these systems, it does not require a separate space for it to be fabricated or installed or constructed. So anaerobic baffled reactor, it works like you can see small walls constructed. A long rectangular tank is divided into small compartments using a baffle. Now this baffle, it's just given to delay the flow from one chamber to another. Now one chamber to another, because in the first chamber there will be sludge. Time is provided for the microorganisms to come in contact with the sludge for better degradation, and then the water moves into the second baffle. Again, it is exposed to a second set of bacteria, which is there, microorganisms, which are there in the second chamber. And as in a similar manner, it moves from one chamber to another. So by the time it reaches the last chamber, it undergoes complete degradation. At least 80 to 90% COD is removed and it comes out. So whatever gas that is produced, water treatment is there, as well as the gas that is produced, it's collected on the surface. If you want, you can collect it. Gas can be recovered in terms of biogas or it can be let out. And the treated water, especially when you talk about the decentralized unit, which the anaerobic baffled reactor constructed at the bottom or the underground near below the car parking, there the treated water is directly taken to a wetland or a reed bed system, where the nitrates or the nutrients are taken, and the clarified water, it's just taken for any reuse purpose or a simple gardening purpose. So anaerobic baffled reactor, the concept was developed by McCarthy. It's a modification of UASP reactor and it has baffles. I've already explained these points. And the retention time, it's around, the solid retention time is 100 days and liquid retention time or the hydraulic retention time is around 20 to 48 hours. So this is the next, the advantages and disadvantages. If you see, it removes almost 90% of COD, 95% of POD and total suspended solids. So advantage and disadvantage, if you see the advantages, it's very simple, inexpensive, and very less amount of sludge is produced, low operating costs, and then high solid retention, and then low HRT. The disadvantage, again, same, just like any other anaerobic system, they require a long startup period and effluent treatment is required, and pathogens are reduced very less. You need to have a tertiary treatment to remove these pathogens. Now, this is one of the recent technology, upcoming technology, which is again used for the extraction of energy. It's the microbial fuel cells. Now, this is a device which is it's a bioelectrochemical system which is used to harness power from the microorganisms. So if you see, it's a reactor where you have microorganisms. I mean, wastewater, it is subjected to wastewater. Now, the microorganisms, as usual, they consume this substrate, the organic content which is present in the wastewater, they consume and they convert it into the electrons and protons. Now, the electrons, the system also has anode and a cathode. As I told you, it's a bioelectrochemical system. So, it has an anode and a cathode, and the substrate is wastewater. So, the microorganisms convert this substrate and then convert it into electrons and protons. Now, electrons are again carried through the external circuit, and then current is produced. And the protons, the anode and the cathode, it is separated by a proton exchange membrane. The protons cross this proton exchange membrane and then reach the cathode, where the cathode chamber is provided with the oxygen. They combine and they produce water. So this is the bioelectrochemical system. So this is again gaining more attention for the past two decades, and even pilot plants are being experimented and then used because it generates electricity as well as wastewater treatment, and it is considered as one of the sustainable system. So so if you talk about anode, different materials are used, like carbon cloth, carbon brush, graphite felt, platinum nickel foam, and all it's used. Same is the case for cathode also. And the proton exchange membrane is generally Nafion or any salt bridge is used. Now, these are the different electrode materials which are used for this, the microbial fuel cells. So, as I told you, there are different carbon materials are there, like carbon cloth, brush, rod, mesh, then felt, activated carbon, granular activated carbon, then stainless steel plate, so a copper sheet, gold sheet. So there are many types are being used. Now, there are two mechanisms which are generally used for electron transfer. Again, I'm not getting into the details, I'll just outline. One is by direct transfer, where the bacteria themselves carry the electrons that is produced during the degradation process directly to the anode surface. That's one thing. There are only a specific group of bacteria which is there, which plays a role in carrying the electrons directly to the anode surface. So those bacteria include Salmonella, Pseudomonas, Alcalophila, Aeruginosa, and Geobacter sulfureducens. So these group of bacteria, they do a direct transfer of electrons to the anode surface. But they have a special appendages called as the conductive pili or nanowires, through which they carry it directly to the anode surface. But wherever these bacteria are not there, or where they are very less in number, you need an indirect electron transfer takes place. So here there are mediators are required, like the some chemicals are added which helps in carrying the electrons to the anode surface. So popularly used mediators are methyl red, neutral red, and some excretions. Some excretions of microorganisms are also used for indirect electron transfer. Now, substrates, if you see, they can treat simple to complex substrates, even simple glucose, acetate, butyrate and all these things can be used from simple substrates to the complex wastewaters are all used. Simple substrates to complex wastewaters are being treated by this, microbial fuel cells, like the domestic sewage, industrial wastewater like the brewery, chocolate industry wastewater, piggery, dairy, and distillery wastewater all are used. And even landfill leachate are treated. Now, this table summarizes the MFC performance and how much COD is removed and how much power is being produced from when different types of wastewater is being used. And if you see, distillery wastewater is around 836 milliwatt per meter square of the anode surface. That much power density is produced. Same, the vegetable oil industry also produce a very high amount, and followed by the dairy. And so there are, again, there are a lot of research going on to, because there are a lot of limitations which happen here, and there are a lot of research under process. So microbial electrolysis cell is again a modification of MFC. In MFC, direct electricity is produced. In MEC, what happens? Again, it is done under complete anaerobic condition. In MFC, the anode chamber is under anaerobic condition. Cathode give the aeration. But microbial electrolysis cell, it is done under complete anaerobic condition. Here, instead of electricity, hydrogen is produced. Again, as I mentioned previously, hydrogen is a clean fuel, and it generates, it has more energy yield. So hydrogen is the energy of a future, or so more focus is there on hydrogen energy. So microbial electrolysis cell, they convert wastewater and produce energy. But only difference in between electrolysis cell and microbial fuel cells is it requires the minimum amount of potential, DC potential, which has to be given from externally to drive the the electrons, okay, which is produced during the microorganisms. In general, the electrons that are produced during the substrate oxidation by microorganisms, it's very less. So this energy, it's not sufficient to drive the protons, and so that it reaches the cathode and gets reduced there. So you need to supplement it with a small potential of energy so that hydrogen is produced. The protons, they produce hydrogen. So the in other words, if you can say, the hydrogen reduction potential is very less than the anodic potential, and which makes it unfavorable to drive the reaction ahead. So that is why a small potential is applied as a DC supply. Again, this is the different substrates which are used and the respective hydrogen production rate. Again, the technology is it's still under infancy, but you can see some places, the pilot plants are also under exploration. Yes, to summarize, I would say wastewater treatment systems are self-sustaining. And why it is called as a biorefinery? Because it is acting as a resource, not only energy, lot of other value added products are also being produced from the wastewater. So wastewater is no longer considered as a waste material, it is considered as a resource. So for production of energy, I've given you many examples of technologies like the anaerobic digesters, and upflow anaerobic sludge blanket reactors, anaerobic baffled reactors, microbial fuel cells, and microbial electrolysis cell to obtain energy from the sludge and directly from wastewater. Apart from that, there are also other value added products which are produced. So if the system becomes a self-sustaining system, or if it becomes a biorefinery, what happens is the impact that it creates through emissions into the external environment will be minimized. And as a result, the impact that the wastewater treatment system creates on the climate change will be minimized. So with this, I complete my presentation. And once again, I thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to share my views about the climate change, impact of climate change on water treatment system and vice versa. I hope the audience would have enjoyed the session. If there are any questions, I'll be happy to answer. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Engineer Sunita Kupal, Assistant Professor, Civil Engineering here.
Yeah, ma'am.
Yes, any participants, if you have any query, please ask. Any participant, if you have any query, you can ask to ma'am. मैम मुझे लग रहा है कि आपने अपने जो प्रेजेंटेशन थी उसमें ही सब इतना कुछ क्लियर कर दिया कि किसी का कोई क्वेरी बचा ही नहीं. सो थैंक यू सो मच मैम एंड थैंक्स अ लॉट फॉर योर वैल्यूएबल एंड इन्फॉर्मेटिव एक्सपर्ट लेक्चर ऑन वाटर बायो रिफाइनरी एंड एनर्जी एक्सट्रैक्शन फ्रॉम वेस्ट वाटर. थैंक्स अ लॉट. थैंक यू मैम.
Thank you so much. It was really a pleasure to be here. Thank you so much for once again. Thank you so much for the opportunity. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Sunita Kotwal.
Yeah. Can I exit or is there any question?
Thanks, ma'am.
Yeah, I'll exit. Ma'am. Thank you.
So thanks to all the participants for patience hearing. Now the time for lunch break. We will again join at 2:15 p.m. Thank you.